Thanks for tuning in. I'm Craig Lieberman, and I've been tinkering on cars since 1980. I've owned more than 40 cars in my life. Some were heroes, some were zeros. But never in my wildest dreams would I ever guess that three of my cars would go on to star in a motion picture franchise. My Supra, my GTR, and my Maxima all had starring roles in Universal's Fast and Furious movies. Over the next 3 years, I'd serve Universal as a technical advisor. I helped choose the cars, procure the parts, oversee their builds, and support both production and post-production. I've got some great stories to tell, and that's why I created this channel. I hope you like the video.
It's time to talk about the 10 worst cars in the Fast and Furious movies. Universal has destroyed literally hundreds of cars while making these movies. But today, I'm going to share a list of some cars that really probably should have been destroyed before they ever appeared on film. So let's jump in. Of course, in the first movie of the franchise, the cars were the stars. Because of this, director Rob Cohen was careful to select actual real-life car show trophy winners to star in his movie. In Too Fast, Too Furious, there was a new director in town, and his team seemed to be hell-bent on making the movie cars look more like they just came out of an episode of Pimp My Ride, with some notable exceptions, of course. With Tokyo Drift, Universal changed directors and production teams again, and this meant that Dennis MacArthur was given the nod and took over as picture car coordinator. Dennis, of course, grew up with muscle cars like most of us here in Southern California, so it's no surprise we've seen more of them in the later movies. Frankly, many of Dennis's team's creations have been nothing short of amazing and wonderful, but if we're being honest, there were a few that baffled even us hardcore car guys. While each of the movies in the franchise had some amazing and memorable cars, each of the movies also had at least one or two cars that left us scratching our heads, right? So here's my list of what I personally believe are vile piles of rubbish cars that you'll see in the Fast and Furious movies so far. At number 10, I have to start with the Maserati Ghibli from Fast 7. The Ghiblis have had a bad reputation for many reasons and for a long time. Ever since these things were introduced in 2013, they've been known for cheap interiors, old technology, poor reliability, and uncompetitive pricing. Today, they're up to $110,000 for these Italian turds. Remarkable given that just a few years ago, they were still at $80,000, which was overpriced then. But 2 years later, if you bought an $80,000 Maserati, you could buy one for less than 30 grand. Now they're even 25 grand. It seems that Ghiblis, like most Maseratis, lose their value faster than a stripper housewife. Why such a huge depreciation? Since 2016, Maserati has ranked dead last in reliability scores across 40 different brands. No surprise, given that Maseratis have been garbage for more than 40 years. In fact, during its history, Maserati has changed ownership at least 6 times. In other words, they've been passed around like a blunt at a party, and frankly, it's pretty ironic given that you really need to be high to want to buy one of these cars. Every one of these Maseratis I've ever been in has at least 2 warning lights triggered, and owners of these cars usually defer maintenance for years because of the expense. If you buy a used one, you better set aside $5,000 to $10,000 to fix everything the previous owner neglected. It's called deferred maintenance, and it's why these cars depreciate. In case I'm not being clear, these cars are rubbish. Ninth on my list is the massively disappointing BMW 3 Series from Too Fast, Too Furious. My original concept was a replica of the PTG E36 M3 of that era. But when Keith Brian Burns and the illustrious art department got a hold of it, it was decided that the car would be one color. It would not look anything like the race car I had been showing them. It also wouldn't be lowered, which left us trying to fill up the huge wheel arches. Stunt cars can't be lowered because they need the ground clearance for obvious reasons. They also need to be able to get on and off the trailers frequently. The only way to make any reasonable effort to close the wheel gap was to buy huge wheels. These cars I think came with 17s or 18s, but the art department chose to put 20-inch chrome Giovanna wheels, which weighed I don't know how much. This was surely influenced by Tyrese. In fact, I knew it for sure when Tyrese said, "Hey, I like the car." I knew that car was a disaster. It was terrible. At that point, I just ignored it. To make matters worse, these cars were not even M3s, even though it was what advertised that they were. They were in fact 323s and they were using automatic transmissions. They were so slow, the stunt guys were concerned that they wouldn't be able to do the stunts that we had written into the script. After the movie, one of these cars sold for a paltry $11,000 and it took a long time to sell at that. Frankly, the car wasn't worth 5 grand. Today, this car is a forgotten side note, thankfully. Number 8 on my list is the 1950 Chevy Fleetline from the racing scene in Cuba. And it's on this list for good reason. Look, I get that some people like rooting for the underdog, but come on, man. They show on screen a turbocharged small block Chevy engine, but the turbocharger was completely fake. It was hollowed out and it was just an air intake. I guess one could argue that this vehicle was representative of what you might find in communist Cuba, but that doesn't make this car any better. It's still a junkyard rust bucket that will probably give you tetanus just by looking at it. And before you come at me with your comments, hey, there's not too many cool cars in Cuba, nonsense. Actually, there are. In fact, there are plenty of 1950s Chevy Bel Airs on the island that are in good shape. Google it. They should have used one of these, but nope, they didn't. Thankfully, this Chevy fleet line was killed with the fire at the end of the race, and we probably never see it again. Thank you, Jesus. Number 7 on my list is gonna piss some people off. Nila's RX-8. The RX-8 is like the redheaded Iranian stepchild that no one seemed to want, at least here in the United States. The only people I ever saw driving these things were old white guys who wore pocket protectors and had bad sunglasses. And maybe some kids who stepped up, arguably, barely, from a Chevy Cobalt or a Dodge Neon. It's not a sports car. Negative. It never caught on with the tuner crowd in the USA for many, many reasons. Not the least of which was the fact that the car wasn't even turbocharged. It was even slower and had less horsepower than its predecessor, the RX-7. Its wheezy, naturally aspirated 232 horsepower made it lethargic at best and disappointing at worst. Yes, it revved fast, but if it's like a Honda and it makes a lot of noise and doesn't go anywhere, what's the point? Although we added a turbocharger to that car, it was still a low 15-second car. So while it wasn't one of the slowest cars in the movies, it was certainly one of the most unimaginative. And I'm not sure who designed the graphics for this thing, but it was another wild miss. The days of following body contour lines with a thin paintbrush were over in the 1970s, man. As for two-tone faded paint jobs, weren't we done with that in the 1960s? I mean, who's running the art department at Universal? It's like they weren't even trying with this car, to be honest with you. It's fitting that they gave it tinted windows because I wouldn't want to be seen in that car either. Number 6 on my list is going to confuse some people, but not if people are in the know. I'm talking about the Jensen Interceptor. I know some people say, what? That car was cool, man. To those people, I'd say, you didn't grow up with these land yachts. I did. When it came out, we were all confused. Was it a station wagon? Was it a James Bond car? Was it a gentleman's sports car? I guess only if that gentleman knew nothing about sports cars, you could call it a sports car, I suppose, but that's a reach. Dennis McCarthy called this car a cool car. Respectfully, I'm going to have to disagree. It was a cool concept. It was a tragic execution. If you start off with a turd, all you can do is polish the turd. From its fishbowl rear hatch reminiscent of the AMC Pacer to its odd C-pillar, this car has a look only a mother could love. It just was not a pretty car. Couple that with British electrical wiring, which always looks like Chef Boyardee cooked this shit up, and you have a recipe for disappointment. The pièce de résistance was the giant Chrysler V8 mated to the lackluster Chrysler 727 torque flight transmission, which was a 3-speed. A manual 4-speed would have been better, but who really cares? Like most British cars of that era, you usually saw more of these cars on flatbed car haulers than you did on the roads. Fortunately, Dennis and the production car team knew that these drivetrains were weak and rubbish and instead used LS3 crate engines, which of course were the same engines used in the 2008-2009 Camaro SS, as I recall. Fortunately, no one has been dumb enough to try and replicate this car, or maybe they did, but it burned down from bad electrical wiring before they got finished, so I've never seen one. Number 5 has to be the Caprice Classic used in Fast 7. These cars represented the worst decade of American cars in history, the 1980s. The Chevy Caprice, although having been around since mid-1960s, the car had really devolved over the years into sort of a land yacht of a car, but it had the equivalent of a tiny trolling motor powering it. It just didn't make sense. In the 1980s, the 4.3 V6 for this car made a measly 140 horsepower, and the top V8 only made 170 horsepower. But the seats were more like living room couches and tacky fake wood accents were everywhere. This is what American cars were in the 1980s. The Caprice was designed for basic transportation. It was never a sports car or sports sedan. Cops used them, taxi companies used them, and parents with no tastes in cars used them. They were just appliances, man. In Fast 7, though, Ludacris used one built by the Picture Car team. And maybe you're starting to notice a recurring theme in these Fast movies from basically Fast 4 onward. In many cases, they're just taking a crummy car that was sitting in a junkyard, they rip out what's left of the crummy interior, then they cut out the rest, install some sheet aluminum door panels, slap in some cheap reused racing seats they had left over from the previous movie, and then install the gauges out of another car left over from the previous movie and just slap them into this car. And that's been the modus operandi for the past several movies. It kind of makes sense if you think about it. If the car is a throwaway car, why do anything fancy? It doesn't make any sense. In fact, why even make it flashy? Screw it, paint it a primer color. Who cares? It's gray. It's got Keystone steel wheels on it. It was just garbage. If you were a fan of Caprices from this era, I'm betting that your childhood sucked. If you're a fan of this movie car now, you're old enough to know better. These cars were a dime a dozen back then. They were slow. They had the turning radius of the USS Nimitz aircraft carrier. They took an hour and a half to stop from 60 miles per hour. They took 11 seconds to get to 60 miles per hour. Even with the V8, it would only run a quarter mile in just under 18 seconds, and that was the 1980s. This car was surely built to be disposable in the movie, and essentially the picture car team knew this, and they just polished the turd knowing that it would be flushed just after one appearance. And basically, it stunk. Number four on this list should be no surprise to anyone if you know me or if you've been following me for a while. So here's a riddle. What do you get when you take a JDM car known for being a pinnacle of Japanese technology, one that has proven itself in racing, and one has been admired by fans for decades, and then you basically paint it like you would if you were running the TV show Pit My Ride. You slap on some heavy chrome wheels and put on a giant scoop. What do you get? You get Tejas Acura NSX, an evil so unspeakable even diehard Acura fans refuse to acknowledge this car's existence. A car so ugly that no one on earth has tried to replicate it since the movie. Why not? Because it's fugly. It's so ugly that even Acura engineers were saying, "We don't like a Fast and Furious NSX. It's a no good old." And that's a direct quote. Or maybe not. My original concept, of course, was based on the Autobox JGTC car, but as shown here, but John Singleton's production team was probably more influenced by MTV's Pimp My Ride. I don't even remember if it was out by then, but maybe they knew something I didn't. My paint scheme ideas were rejected, my wheel suggestions were completely ignored, and the roof intake duct was not at all what I envisioned, despite showing them detailed pictures. The final color they chose was really kind of a fluke. It was a last minute decision. How did they choose it? It was simple. It was a leftover couple of cans of paint that we had from one of the other cars that we painted on set. The wheels, of course, were a last minute decision, and given that the actor was black, there was a lot of discussion about what wheels should be on this car between me and the art department. Apparently they went for the stereotypical chrome wheels, and they ultimately chose Giovanna wheels. They're smaller, I think they're 18s in front, or 19s in front and 20s in the back or something like that. But those wheels were really heavy and it just didn't fit an Acura NSX, but painted in that scheme with those graphics, It basically just appealed to a few people, but most people look at the car and say it's awful. And I'm one of them. We're in the top three now. Now, if you've been following my channel for any length of time, you've probably heard me talk about this car. In fact, I've talked about it on many occasions. Not just because it was the wrong car choice for this particular role, which was unfortunately out of my control. It was yet another example of focusing on just one styling trend to the detriment of the finished movie. And let me explain. Of course, I'm talking about Tyrese's purple Eclipse Spider from Too Fast, Too Furious. In my mind's eye, if you're going to go out and catch bad guys, you don't take a super slow convertible that stands out like a sore thumb. You take something fast, sleek, and stealthy. Not in John Singleton's mind, though. Nope, we got this instead. Tyrese picked the paint job personally. The wheels and the interior color were also picked by him personally. He was right on only one of these choices. The original color that we had done with the Eclipse was yellow, which was requested by the art department. However, when Tyrese saw it, thankfully he had a moment of clarity and he shot it down immediately. In fact, when he saw it, he said, "Oh, hell no, I ain't driving no Lakers car." Maybe he was a Clippers fan, I don't know. But actually, that was the right decision. Getting rid of the yellow interior for a gray interior was a better choice. But it still couldn't save this car. It was still ugly. It's not a tuner car, man. It's just they took like a tuner slash lowrider car. There's so many other better cars that we could have used, a WRX, a 350Z, an E36, a Hachiroko. I could go on and on and on and on and on. SC300s. JZX, all sorts of cars. But in any case, we were stuck with it, and despite my repeated request to ditch this car and use something better, it ended up in the film anyway. Doesn't mean I like it anymore. But fortunately, there's a bright side to this. Because of the highly complex airbrushing, only a few people of the world have tried to replicate this car. And if they've done it, God bless them. It's quite a feat, I know what it is. But I want to be clear on something. I don't just dislike this car just because of its looks. I dislike it because there were many other JDM cars we could have and should have used for this role, as I mentioned. So this one is a giant miss for me. Could have been so much more. Now we're up to number two, and number two on my list is pretty much every Dodge Charger they've used in, as filler cars in these movies since about Fast Five. I'm not talking about the old Dodge Chargers, the 69, 70s, and so forth. I'm talking about all the Chargers they've been using since Fast and Furious 5. Sick and tired of it. I'm done with it. I'm over it. We got to do better. Hey, Universal, we get it. Dodge is paying for product placement. But when these movies keep showing Dodge Chargers that look like they just rolled off a dealership's lot, it's time to start thinking about changing it up. And now, without further ado, the number one car on my list, which won't surprise anybody, it can only be one car, one so heinous, one so hideous, one so absurd that it is loathed and ridiculed by every human on Earth over the age of 13. What car am I talking about? Of course, I'm talking about Little Bow Wow's Volkswagen Touran, better known as the Hulkmobile. It should be called a Hunkmobile because it was a hunk of I think director Justin Lin was trolling with this. We clearly had a little fun with this one, given that he was a huge fan of the Incredible Hulk since he was a child. Hey, I get it, man. I was a fan of Pamela Anderson back in the day, but I never built a car with a pair of giant hands on the hood, if you catch my drift. From the fuzzy hair on the roof to the odd hand gestures that I guess were supposed to look like fists, but to me they look more like someone was pleasuring himself. Some of the cars we have seen in these movies seem cool to us at the time, but with age comes wisdom, and today most of us are now old enough to look back at these cars through a new lens. We have to realize that some of these cars were never great even when they were new. But we grew to love them because sitting in a theater in front of a big giant silver screen, Universal somehow made these cars cool. This has been the magic that Universal has created during the franchise's 20-year run. And some of us are still spellbound by this wizardry. That's what makes this franchise fun to people of all ages, even to a cranky old guy like me. Hope you enjoyed my little poke at these cars, and I hope you watch my other videos. And if you're liking what you're seeing, please, please smash that subscribe button. Thanks again, everybody.